Good morning, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, live inside the Beltway. Georgia votes today. Will Herschel Walker come out and talk, or Raphael Warnock? I talk with David Drucker of the Washington Examiner, review the day's news, talk to you about GOP news generally, a new podcast launching on highly concentrated Hugh. Stay tuned right here on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
There's a reason that we live so far from Hollywood. In the country, looking hard to find a home. Well, nothing perfect or considered, but we're so damn good. It's the story of your
morning, Glory America, Bonjour, hi, Canada, Hugh Hewitt, live inside the Beltway on this Tuesday, December 6th, Georgia runoff day. And if you have not yet voted, Georgia's going to be very close down there. I'm going to talk with Senators Rick Scott, who's chairman of the National Republican Senatorial Committee. I'm going to be talking with Senator Tom Cotton, with Senator Dan Sullivan, all three about the race in Georgia and about the path ahead for the GOP. Also going to be talking with David Drucker, Byron York, and about the GOP generally. And I want to add as well, the last segment of the on-air show today will be Kristen Waggoner, who argued the 303 creative case before the United States Supreme Court yesterday. So there's a lot to listen to today. Also want to let you know that beginning today, I'm changing the podcast up a little bit. Highly Concentrated Hugh is still Highly Concentrated Hugh. And you will get all of the key segments from the show in Highly Concentrated Hugh. But I'm beginning it each day with original content that you've not heard on the radio show, about the GOP race and the GOP heading into 2024. Now, I'm sure all of you know that this is going to be a roller derby of a presidential nomination process. Of course, former President Trump is running, and that always means great fun for those of us who cover politics. But so may or are Texas Governor Greg Abbott, former New Jersey Governor Chris Christie, Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, former South Carolina Governor and U.N. Ambassador Nikki Haley, Maryland Governor Larry Hogan, former, still the governor, not yet former, Arkansas Governor Asa Hutchinson, South Dakota Governor Kristi Noem, former Vice President Mike Pence, Florida Senator Marco Rubio, Florida Senator Rick Scott, South Carolina Senator Tim Scott, New Hampshire Governor Chris Sununu, Virginia Governor Glenn Youngkin, not running, this is the shorter list, Tom Cotton and Doug Ducey. And then, of course, Donald Trump is running. And Ted Cruz, of course, is in there as well. I've got to redo my list a little bit. I've tried to put it together this morning. I can't cover that every day in the radio show. I've got to do breaking news. I've got to bring up the stories like the Kristen Waggoner coming on and talking about the Supreme Court case yesterday. So every day after the radio show is done, I'm going to record the GOP news that will precede Highly Concentrated Hugh on the Highly Concentrated Hugh podcast. So if you haven't already subscribed to Highly Concentrated Hugh at iTunes, at Spotify, at the Salem Podcast Network, you should now, especially if you are now or have ever been a member of the Republican Party or considering becoming it. This is inside baseball stuff. It's why I'm in the Beltway. It's even why I'm in California or up north, why I talk to everyone in the party every day, all day long. That's my job. What's going on in the world of the Republican Party? If you want to know what's going on in the Democratic world, I will tell you on the radio show, but it doesn't interest me as much as the maneuvering and the inside baseball that goes on as we run up to the most interesting presidential race of my life. And it's going to be a wild ride, even though I'll give you just a little taste of what's going to happen. Just a little bit of a taste. I found the odds last night. I'm doing my prep sheet. Found the odds last night. Vegas betting line on the 2024 presidential election. Ron DeSantis is at plus 120. That means you bet $100, you win $120 on Ron DeSantis. Donald Trump is $162, so he's not a betting favorite over Ron DeSantis right now. Mike Pence jumps up to $1,400. You bet $100, and Mike Pence is the nominee, you'll make $1,400. Nikki Haley, $1,800. Mike Pompeo, $3,300. Tim Scott, $3,300. Ted Cruz, $8,000. Tom Cotton, $8,000. Now, that just tells you that Las Vegas isn't really paying attention much or that there's not much of a market yet because Ted Cruz would be ranked much higher. Indeed, it is traditional in the Republican Party that the person who came in second the last time will get the nomination this time, which would be Ted Cruz came in second last time. He was the only other person to speak at the Cleveland Convention in 2016. But that'll all come. I'll get into that in depth. Let me get to the news of this morning. As I said, Georgia is voting. They've tried to let you, legacy media has tried to tell you it's a blowout, Raphael. They've hinted, they've said that. There's no polling, but all they're doing is, oh gosh, there's early voting. It's so great for Raphael Warnock. 79% of the black votes already turned out. The black vote is crucial to Raphael Warnock, and the early voting really, actually, they don't know. They have no idea, because we've never done this before in Georgia. The runoffs that have occurred before in Georgia have always occurred in January. We don't know what the turnout's going to be today. If you're a Republican, turn around and go and vote right now for Herschel Walker. 50-50 is far better than 51-49. Herschel would make a great senator. He will be able to do exactly what Georgians want him to do. So please get out and vote this morning, Georgia. I'll be reminding you throughout. But that runoff is today. Let's get to the other news. Yesterday was a bad day on the market. In fact, I'll do the market update right now, brought to you by Birch Gold. If you're going to buy gold, go to HughGold.com, HughGold.com, and you might be looking real hard at it. It dropped down to $17.85. You might be opening your end-of-the-year IRA for 2021. You can open that with Birch Gold by texting my name, Hugh, to 989898. Or you might just want to buy actual physical gold because you have no idea what's going on with things like Bitcoin, which hasn't published a morning price yet this morning. Oil this morning is down a little bit because the recession is coming. And yesterday, the markets were mixed. Actually, no, the markets were all bad. Excuse me. Dow was down 482. The S&P was down 72. And the NASDAQ was down 221. As we brace for more and more and more interest rates. From the Wall Street Journal this morning, stocks slide after strong data on factory service sectors. That means that the Fed's recession isn't arriving, so they have to crush the economy more with higher interest rates. PepsiCo is going to lay off hundreds of workers in headquarters roles. So it's not just big tech laying off people left, right, and center. Now PepsiCo is. It's a bad, bad time to be in the marketplace. It's a worse time to be in crypto. The crypto stories are just terrible. The Fed to weigh higher interest rates next year while slowing rises this month. We're expecting a 0.5% rise next week from the Fed. But they're going to give us a clue about that they're not close enough. The market just believes it's really going to get bad next year. Indeed, the Wall Street Journal headline, Wall Street is really, really bearish right now. And PepsiCo is one reason. You know, that's why they're laying off hundreds of people. But the other reason is crypto. $9 billion deal to take crypto group Circle public has been pulled. That isn't flying. The Bob Diamond SPAC was going to do that. Nope, they're not saying that. Online investors who jumped into crypto are saying, now what? Well, right now, if you're in BlockFi or FTX, the other ones that have just shown shakiness, get out. I mean, really, do run away and get your money and do something like get it into gold, buy physical gold. Do something that's actually real and not paper and not run by people like Sam Bankman-Fried. All right, back to the other news. Donald Trump is paying for lawyers of key Mar-a-Lago witnesses. Moreover, they've hired Stan Brand. Now, Stan Brand is a serious player in Washington, D.C. He is a lawyer I interviewed with 35 years ago, and I wanted to work for Stan Brand and Abby Lowell when they had Brandon Lowell. And I thought, okay, I'll go work for those guys, because while they're Democrats, they're really great lowers, both of them, Stan Brand and Abby Lowell. So Kash Patel, who's at the heart of much of the Trump controversy, has hired Stan Brand. There's another person, and Trump's paying for their lawyers, which is a good breakthrough for the former president. Over in Great Britain, police are told to get a backbone and just stop oil protesters are causing chaos around the city, not only defacing everything, but they're really bringing a lot of pain to ordinary Londoners, and it's a group of about 100, and the Brit police are being told, we've had enough of this. As I mentioned to you, the Supreme Court held 2.5 hours of argument in 303 Creative yesterday. I think there's going to be a major First Amendment case. We'll talk with Kristen Waggoner about it later. The Supreme Court seems ready to back the web designer, according to the New York Times, as they should. The Washington Post headline, Supreme Court seems to side with web designer opposed to same-sex marriage, as they should. But, of course, we know what elite media thinks, legacy media. This is the worst headline I've seen in a long time today. USA Today's headline, SCOTUS hears LGBTQ rights cases. Actually, it's got nothing to do with LGBT rights. It's got everything to do with the First Amendment rights of speech of the website designer, Lori. And so that's just a headline writer's attempt to get clicks and a headline writer's bias. Support is slipping in the United States for USAID to Ukraine. We've got to turn that around. I'll talk with Tom Cotton about that yesterday. Blasts have hit Russian air bases and a Russian oil refinery inside of Russia. Moscow launched a missile barrage on Ukraine. These may be false flag attacks setting up additional horrific attacks, but when a drone hit a Russian oil depot the day after Ukraine strikes deep inside of Russia, according to Russia, you get to begin to worry that Russia is planning something beyond freezing the Ukrainians to death this winter. Also a headline, the U.S. altered the HIMARS rocket launchers to keep Ukraine from firing missiles into Russia. Why would we do that? Why did we delay just to make sure? I'll ask Senator Cotton about that. And there's an oil tanker jam off of Turkey. And even despite that, the price of oil is dropping because the recession is going to be long and brutal. The winter ahead is going to be harsh. For all of the GOP news that I can't get to, I will be doing that again on the podcast. You should be subscribed to Highly Concentrated Hugh and GOP News over at Apple iTunes, Spotify, and wherever podcasts come to you. Come right back, America. Lots more ahead on this morning's Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Birch Gold Group.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. You know, I was mentioning to you last segment that you should be subscribed to Highly Concentrated Hugh and GOP News. It's one podcast with two names. Highly Concentrated Hugh is the radio show bits that I put into the podcast, and the GOP News is all the news that the insiders know in D.C. and what they are saying inside the Beltway and at other power centers for the GOP around the country. That can be subscribed to at iTunes, Spotify, the Salem Podcast Network. But while you're doing that, my young friend Julie Hartman has a new podcast as well. She graduated from Harvard this past year and has begun working often as a guest host for... She's on the West Coast, the L.A. girl. And so the West Coast hosts, like Dennis Prager, are using her as a guest host. I would love to have her as a guest host, but I don't want her driving around L.A. at 3 o'clock in the morning. 22-year-old, I'm a dad first, and I talked to her yesterday. If she ever gets set up at home... she'll be a regular guest host for me, along with our regular guys, Ed Morrissey and of course, Colonel Kurt and Bob Franz and Bruce Hooley in Columbus. We got a lot of great guest hosts, but Julie's a rising star, and you ought to be getting her podcast. In the first segment, I talked to you about Birch Gold. Now, I want to read to you something that I got on Ellis News Items this morning. Not in the Wall Street Journal. It's the reason I get Ellis News Items. I personally don't understand crypto, and I've told you I don't buy it. I don't buy Bitcoin or any of the other ones because I don't understand it, and therefore I wouldn't invest in it. I invest in mutual funds, real estate, gold, and of course, Amazon. And Amazon's had a bad run, like a year's bad news, but I don't sell it. It's an investment. I'm not a trader. I don't trade anything. That's not my strong suit. I can tell you everything you want to know about what's going on inside of GOP politics, but I just don't do anything investment-wise. I let professionals handle that. But I do follow the news about crypto, and let me read to you an item in the news items by John Ellis newsletter this morning. Pension funds and other non-bank financial firms have more than $80 trillion of hidden off-balance sheet dollar debt in FX swaps, the Bank for International Settlements said. Its main warning concerned what it described as the FX swaps debt blind spot that risked leaving policymakers in a fog. I want to repeat that. Its main warning concerned what it described as the FX swap debt blind spot that risked leaving policymakers in a fog. FX swap markets, where, for example, a Dutch pension fund or a Japanese insurer borrows dollars and lends euro or yen before later repaying them, have a history of problems. They saw funding squeezes during both the global financial crisis of 2007 and 2008, and again in March 2020 when the COVID-19 pandemic wrought havoc and required central banks such as the U.S. Federal Reserve to intervene with dollar swap lines. The 80 trillion plus hidden debt estimate exceeds the stocks of dollar treasury bills, repo, and commercial paper combined, the BIS said. It has grown from just over $55 trillion a decade ago. While the churn of XF swaps deals was almost $5 trillion a day in April, two-thirds of daily global FX turnover. For both non-U.S. banks and non-U.S. non-banks, such as pension funds, dollar obligations from FX swaps are now double their on-balance sheet dollar debt, it is estimated. The BIS research paper is here. It will make your head hurt. Okay, how do I understand that? I understand that the FX collapse has deep and grave implications for international financial markets beyond the million creditors of FTX. I think that's what that means. And the FX swap debt, I don't know if it's FTX or if it, I don't know what that means. All I know is that there's a lot of stuff that goes on in the international financial world that leads you to buy things you know, like Amazon for me and gold for me or your house or anything you can put your hands on, because this doesn't sound good to me. And I'm one of those broadcasters, one of those news people who say, I have no idea what this means. All I know is if it's leading John Ellis news items, it's very, very bad news. You know what's very, very good news? You're supporting Angel Tree. You're supporting Angel Tree in ways I never imagined. Please keep sending $25, $50, $100. Every $25 provides a Christmas present for the child of an incarcerated prisoner. You can find the banner to help the Angel Tree Givers over at the top of HughHewitt.com. Please help these kids enjoy a little bit of Christmas. They'll get a Bible and a present and a handwritten note from their mom or dad in jail if you come through for them. The banner is at the top, the very top of HughHewitt.com. I'll be right back. Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt live inside the Beltway this Tuesday morning. It's Georgia runoff day. To all my listeners on AM 920 in Atlanta and my affiliates in Macon and Athens and Savannah, get out there, please, wherever you are in Georgia, northern Georgia, if you're listening on the live stream on podcast, call your friends in Georgia, tell them to go out and vote. Legacy Media has been doing everything they can to tell you that Raphael Warnock is running away with this. It's going to be a 2% race one way or the other, and I need you to get out there and vote, Georgia. It actually could be a one-vote race. This might be one of those recounts where you want to cure your ballot. If you have any trouble ballot, call up the campaign, find the Secretary of State, cast a provisional, stand in line. I don't know what the weather is in Georgia. I'll look during the break. David Drucker will fill me in. Right now, I want to go to yesterday's Supreme Court case and our friends at Alliance Defending Freedom, ADF. Great, great friends of the program, sponsors of it occasionally when they try and raise money and add members to it. And I really appreciate that you all support them. They were out there winning. You know, they've won 14 times at the Supreme Court in the last decade. 14 times. They're called a hate group by the Southern Poverty Law Center because they're a bunch of wacky lefty extremists and they hate the fact that ADF is the best legal defense fund in the United States. So yesterday, the case of 303 Creative LLC versus Alanis was argued. And here is the SCOTUS blog opening two graphs so that I give you a neutral description. The Supreme Court heard oral argument on Monday in the case of Lori Smith, a website designer and a devout Christian who wants to expand her business to include wedding websites, but only for opposite-sex couples. Smith is challenging a Colorado law that prohibits most businesses from discriminating against LGBTQ customers. Requiring her to create websites for same-sex weddings, she argues, would violate her right to fundamental speech. At the oral argument, Justice Sotomayor asserted that a ruling for Smith would be the first time that the Supreme Court has ruled that commercial businesses could refuse to serve a customer based on race, sex, religion, or sexual orientation. But Chief Justice John Roberts countered that the Supreme Court has never approved efforts to compel speech that is contrary to the Speaker's belief, and his five conservative colleagues signaled that they were likely to join him in a ruling for Smith. I don't think this is close. I've been teaching con law for 25 years. Left-wingers want to make this about denying service to gays. In fact, gays can get a billion different websites to design their same-sex wedding websites. And you know, I've been to same-sex weddings. You know that I supported the recently passed law in the United States Congress that repeals the Defense of Marriage Act and accepts a settled law. The Supreme Court's very emphatic announcement, it is settled law. And the law of the land, I opposed it all the way up until the Supreme Court declared it in Obergefell. And now it's over. It's done. Not an issue. But imposing on individuals with deep Christian beliefs, or any other, could be Jewish, could be Muslim, could be Buddhist, an obligation to serve same-sex couples in spite of their long-standing views on marriage is an infringement on their First Amendment speech rights. This led to quite a lot of argument before the court. I want to play for you a little bit. First, let's go to the left. Justice Brown Jackson, cut number five.
A public business. I'm a photographer. My belief is that, you know, I'm doing It's a Wonderful Life scenes. That's what I'm offering. Okay? I want to do video depictions of It's a Wonderful Life. And I'm knowing that movie very well. I want to be authentic, and so only white children and families can be customers for that particular product. Everybody else can, I'll give to everybody else, I'll sell them anything they want, just not the It's a Wonderful Life depictions. I'm expressing something, right, for your purposes, that's speech. What about, what's the other step? It's speech, and I can say anti-discrimination laws can't make me sell the It's a Wonderful Life package to non-white individuals.
That is nuts. That's got nothing to do with any real. I'm going to ask Kristen Waggoner, went through her head. She'll be very diplomatic. That's just nuts. I have no idea what Justice Brown Jackson was asking. Here's another Justice Brown Jackson. Cut number six.
Selling this, I'm going to be violating my own beliefs. So let me just ask you another quick hypo. So I'm trying to understand the extent to which this matters that she's a speaker as opposed to a restaurant. So I sell food, and one line of products that I make is from scratch for particular customers that are based on my grandmother's cherished family recipes. My dearly departed grandmother was clear that she only wanted to provide this kind of nourishment for people who share our same religious heritage. So I call these products Grandma Helen's Protestant Provisions. And I sit with each customer who comes in and I hear about their faith and their family, and I customize the recipe for them after having this discussion. So the food is not expressive, right? I'm not speaking in my food, but I am trying to convey that only certain people get to partake in this product. Can I do that consistent with the First Amendment or not?
No, and in this situation, as you said, in terms of a caterer, the caterer is not engaging in speech. In terms of your initial statements or questions, speech is speech, whether it's paid or pro bono.
But don't we have cases that suggest that people's conduct can be expressive? I thought there was a whole line of cases that said you didn't have to actually have an express message. You could be acting in such a way as to express a message. And in my restaurant hypo, I'm saying if I sell to non-Protestants, I'd be expressing a message contrary to Grandma Helen's core beliefs.
You're speaking through conduct at that point, and that is a different analysis. In terms of the expressive conduct test, the court has already articulated what those tests are and what a reasonable person would observe. But in that case, you're talking essentially about status discrimination. There's no message that she is creating that would be compelled in that way. That would simply be service. In addition, though, I think it's important to recognize the breadth of the public accommodation law. You've started with a statement about freelance writers. At oral argument at the Tenth Circuit, my friend in Colorado admitted that freelance writers are considered to be public accommodations under
the
law.
All right, well, I'll ask them about that, but what about my photographer? My photographer is speaking.
Did you notice that she switched hypos? Justice Brown Jackson's hypo made no sense. I've been teaching con law for 25 years, and, you know, there's a 2.5 hour. She's a new justice. Maybe she's not got this done, but she's been on the D.C. Circuit for 2 years, so she knows how to question lawyers. That hypo is so absurd and so obtuse. Not obtuse, obscure. It's an obscure, I have no idea what she's trying to communicate other than she's trying to bring race into this or religion into this in a way that makes you sound silly by saying it's expressive conduct. Kristen, when I said that's conduct and that's a different test, we're talking about speech. 303 Creative is about speech, about an artist creating a website, and that is art. It's not baking, it's not a product, we're not justifying racial discrimination, and it can't be justified. Repeatedly, Colorado tried to equate website design for weddings with accommodations for race. And Justice Alito just had it up to here at one point with that. Cut number 8.
In light of what Justice Kennedy wrote in Obergefell about honorable people who object to same-sex marriage, do you think it's fair to equate opposition to same-sex marriage with opposition to interracial marriage?
Yes, because in how the law applies, not in the discussion with folks, because of course honorable people have different views on this issue. But I think when you look at what Justice Kennedy said there, the way to honor that requirement is, as this court has set forth in Fulton, in Masterpiece, of having a rigorous interrogation to make sure that there are neutral and generally applicable laws applied in fact that way, that don't single out religion. And then the very next sentence of what Justice Kennedy said in Obergefell talked about when it transformed that honest and decent disagreement transformed into enacted law and policy, the necessary consequence is to put the imprimatur of the state on that exclusion. And I think if this court were to say that the imprimatur of this court would allow a web designer to say no same-sex people allowed, or allow a school photographer to say no pictures of...
Do you think Justice...
Eric Olson, they did not send their best out of Colorado. And this goes to my long-held view that unless you are very good at this, you ought not to do it because you want to argue before the Supreme Court. I've been asked in the past to recommend Supreme Court litigators. I said, well, that list is pretty easy. That's Paul Clement. See if you can get Paul Clement to do the case for you. People have asked me, would you argue? I said, absolutely not. Never. I've never done it before. I've argued before the Ninth Circuit. I would never go to the Supreme Court because I would sound like Eric Olson, which is overprepared and underthoughtful and just not in command of the facts and the precedent. Finally, I want to go to Justice Gorsuch throwdown at one point, because you don't screw around with Justice Gorsuch, who's from Colorado. He's like Coach Prime. It's Justice Prime here. If you're not following that, Deion Sanders has become the coach of the University of Colorado, and Buff fans everywhere are excited about Coach Prime coming to Boulder. Coach Prime hired the Kent State head coach to be his offensive coordinator yesterday. He's getting lots of people in the transfer portal, but I digress. Justice Prime, otherwise known as Justice Gorsuch, is from Boulder as well. He knows the Colorado law, and he knows what Colorado's been up to. They've been defying the Supreme Court. They kept dragging Jack Phillips of Masterpiece Cake Shop again and again and again. And I think the court's going to bring the hammer down on Colorado, and they're going to make him stop. But here is what Justice Gorsuch, Justice Prime, had to say yesterday, cut number 7.
Colorado, you can't change their religious belief, right?
No, but well,
and you protect religious beliefs under the statute, right? That is one of the protected characteristics,
yes,
in theory.
And in practice. If it wasn't in practice, we had heard about it over the past several years, and my friend has pointed to no example where this has been applied.
Mr. Phillips did go through a re-education training program pursuant to Colorado law, did he not, Mr. Olson?
He went through a process that ensured he was familiar with
it. It was a re-education program, right?
It was not a re-education program.
What do you call it?
It was a process to make sure he was familiar with Colorado law.
Someone might be excused for calling that a re-education.
I strongly disagree, Justice Gorsuch.
Thank you, Mr. Olson.
Oh, great. He lost Justice Gorsuch in about 5 seconds. I strongly disagree, Justice Gorsuch. Okay. Goodbye, Justice Gorsuch, who's really occasionally a swing vote on the court. And they've had it. They've just had it with Colorado. Colorado has stepped on repeatedly people who have sincerely held religious beliefs that protect them from obliging them to participate in same-sex marriages with which they simply cannot in good conscience agree. Right? It's so easy. A caterer can't turn down a same-sex wedding. A caterer is putting up chairs and tables and serving food. A baker who has to design the cake or a website designer who must do the speech cannot be obliged to bend their knee. It is that simple. Let me ask all of you out there as well, you know what else is simple? We are going to have a cruise in September of next year that is terrific and absolutely fabulous, and I'll be a Christmas present for your beloved spouse. Fetching Mrs. Hewitt and I have never done a two-week cruise before. We are doing one with Frosch Travel. We begin in London. We end up in Monte Carlo. We go to France and Spain and Portugal. Guy Benson is coming along, and Guy will be speaking the first week primarily about presidential politics, as I will be talking about presidential politics, as I do every day on the GOP news segment of the Highly Concentrated Hugh podcast. But you got to call 818-853-8536 for information or booking. There's also a banner at hughhewitt.com. You can go and click on that if you would like. But call 818-853-8536, 818-853-8536, or go to hughhewitt.com and click on the banner. ReliefFactor.com, I'll take it next hour because I haven't opened the package yet today. ReliefFactor.com, I will take it next hour. I needed it last night. We went to see The Fabelmans. I think Steven Spielberg must hate Seth Rogen. Now, I don't like Seth Rogen at all, so maybe Steven Spielberg hates him enough to cast him as the ultimate villain in his life, but Seth Rogen went over his head when he... Anyway, we should send some ReliefFactor.com to people who have to sit through The Fabelmans because it's about 100 hours long, and it will really hurt your back. I enjoyed it, but you got to be ready for a really long movie, and you got to be ready for a lot of hating on Seth Rogen. ReliefFactor.com, ReliefFactor.com. Coming back with David Drucker right after this, America. Stay tuned. Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt live on Georgia Primary Day. I am joined inside the Beltway by David M. Drucker, although he might be down in Georgia. Good morning, David Drucker from the Washington Examiner. Are you, in fact, in Georgia?
Not this time. I promised my wife I would take a few weeks off of traveling after an extended 7 weeks of consecutive travel.
That would do it. Okay, tell me something. What do you think is going to happen in Georgia, and do you think the media is trying to signal a Warnock victory?
Well, my best sources in Georgia, who are Republicans, aren't very optimistic. They weren't very optimistic 3 weeks ago. They weren't very optimistic when I checked in with them yesterday.
By the way, I agree with that. John Ellis, News Item, said, I think Warnock's going to win, but I wouldn't bet a lot of money on it. And I thought that was an interesting way for a very wired guy to put it.
Well, and that is because the race is still close. Nobody that I talked to that has generally made me look pretty smart about Georgia the past couple of years is predicting a rout of any kind. They've just looked at the early voting numbers. They've looked at the dynamic of the campaign, and they're just not very optimistic. Having said that, there is a pathway. It will finish close. It finished close 2 years ago when there was a pair of runoffs in Georgia for the Senate. So anything's possible. I think we learned that on November 8th of this year, and we'll just have to see how it turns out.
You know, David, you just used one of the greatest hedge lines. I love anything possible comments. That's the way that a pundit like me and a reporter like you says we don't know. But I do think the media, big legacy media, left-wing media, is trying to telegraph a Warnock win. And I don't want Republicans to be depressed in their turnout because I don't think we know anything about a three-week runoff because it's never happened before.
Well, it has happened. It happened in 2008. Saxby Chambliss was forced into a runoff. He was running against a challenger. It was a different.
That was a two-month runoff, David. That was a two-month runoff.
December 6th. I'm pretty sure it was a December 6th runoff, if I recall.
I thought it was the old rule.
Later moved the runoff late, as we had it 2 years ago, and now it's back to kind of where it used to be.
Oh, that's good then. Saxby won.
One thing I would tell you, and this is true of the general election campaign, it's been true of the runoff, which I've just found interesting. People can take it for what it is. These two candidates have been a case of role reversal in the way that they have campaigned. It's something that I experienced being in Georgia, covering them the last 4 or 5 days of the general election, and something I've seen watching this runoff. Warnock has campaigned like the challenger, crisscrossing the state furiously, holding multiple events a day, making himself more sort of available to the media and to voters generally. Herschel Walker, now he's a well-known person, in a sense a famous person, has generally held one event a day, very careful with his media appearances, and that's it. And usually you see that from the incumbent, and you see the multiple events from the challenger. It's just been a very interesting dynamic. I think it might have served Walker better to have been more accessible and to have held more events, but obviously his campaign believes this is the best strategy.
David, you know what I interpreted? You're absolutely right on the factual reporting. I think Brian Kemp said, we've got this. If you're going to win, you're going to win on my machine. You make sure you don't make any mistakes. You stay in the bus. You go everywhere. And they've gone everywhere with the bus, but he's done small groups, off the record stuff. And we've got this. So I think Brian Kemp is all in. I saw his tweet last night, and I think his operation is running, but they've lowered expectations. Everyone, and Rick Scott's coming along here a little bit later in the program. I don't know what he's going to do. He's going to urge everyone to go out and vote, but I'm going to talk with him about that. I got to ask you a completely off-the-wall question, David Drucker. Completely off the wall. I'm beginning for the Hugh, a highly concentrated Hugh podcast today, because 2022 ends today, the 2024 cycle GOP news. And I began with my list of presidential candidates, Donald Trump, of course, but Abbott, Christie, DeSantis, Haley, Hogan, Hutchinson, Noem, Pence, Rubio, Scott, Sununu Yunkin, not running, Tom Cotton and Doug Ducey. That's about it. I haven't left anyone else. The one thing that came to me is Donald Trump's at the top, obviously. He's the only declared one. And so I looked ahead. It could be 30 years from now. I don't know when it's going to happen. Eventually, Donald Trump is going to lie in state in the rotunda of the Capitol of the United States. How big will the crowds be, David Drucker, when his body is in repose at the Capitol of the rotunda?
Well, really good. You know, I didn't cover this part of the future in interim shadow. I tried to look ahead. I didn't get this far ahead. Look, I think Donald Trump's always going to have a dedicated core of loyalists who will always appreciate his approach and his accomplishments over 4 years in office, if that's all it is. But I think the more he dabbles in griping about the election he claims was stolen.
Not going there. What I wanted to know is the size of that core.
I have an answer for you.
Okay.
Wait a minute.
We don't have a lot of runway here, David.
This matters, though. The more he extends beyond that and talks about ignoring the Constitution, the smaller that crowd will be.
Okay, well, that's a fair point. But generally, right now, if the aliens abducted him tomorrow, as my friends at Buckeye talk, how long
would be large?
It would be ongoing, larger than anything we've ever seen in our lifetime, right?
It would compare to Reagan.
And therefore, it would compare to Reagan. Well put. And therefore, people cannot write off Donald Trump for that reason. I always look long-term. People cannot, they can't write him off because of his terrible errors this week. I'll talk with Byron York about that after the break. Drucker, thank you, my friend. David M. Drucker on Twitter. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Come right back. Morning, Glory America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. I'm Hugh Hewitt, live inside the Beltway. As Georgia votes today, it's the last day of election 2022. We'll know by tonight. It may be late, might be tomorrow morning. I think it's going to be close one way or the other. Raphael Warnock and Herschel Walker, I'm urging you to get out there with Herschel. But today ends the 2022 election cycle, and 2024 begins tomorrow. Byron York joins me to talk about both sides of that coin. Good morning, Byron.
Good morning, Hugh.
Now, if you listen to Drucker, and you usually do, you heard me say that I just sense legacy media is attempting to suppress the Republican enthusiasm here by basically signaling it's over. A, do you think I've sensed that wrong? Am I being paranoid? And B, how close is this race?
Well, I did hear you say that, and I actually agree with that. I think it's pretty clear in the last couple of days. We've seen a number of reports saying, looks like it's over, looks like it's over, Warnock is going to win. I dived into this piece, did a piece, I think, on Friday. And the one thing that they have in their favor is saying that the early voting was huge. And it was record-setting. The most votes per early voting per day you had during the general election was like 150,000 or something like that. And this time they had 300,000 people, a much compressed voting period, a day vote. So early voting usually favors Democrats. But I talked to a number of Republicans who said, look, Warnock's going to win the early voting because he did before, but he's going to win it by less. They think they did better in the early voting than they did in the general election. And I think and of course, Herschel Walker won the election day voting. So it is very close. Warnock has had a huge spending advantage. He spent in the runoff $52 million to Herschel Walker's $25 million. So political reporters look at that as well. It does appear that, and David was talking about this, that Warnock just went out and campaigned more physically, more appearances than Herschel Walker did.
And you heard my response. I know that. In fact, Herschel did once the show where he used to do the show like weekly during the regular election. He only did it once, only asked for it once. And the reason was, I suspect, my guess, this is not reported, it's Hugh's hypothetical. Brian Kemp said, we've got this, Herschel. You stay on the bus, go everywhere, sign autographs, pose the Heisman pose, and don't screw up. We've got this. And therefore, I think it's working out fine. But the one story I did see that appeared...
If he wins. We'll know that.
But we'll find out tomorrow. I think it will work out fine if he wins. That will have been... Oh, how brilliant a strategy. They turned it on. And Brian Kemp was on Twitter last night telling everyone, get out there and vote. And Nikki Haley was there with him yesterday. And Tim Scott was there with him yesterday. Everyone's thrown in. But the one stat I saw that leads me in the opposite direction is that the early vote portion of the black vote has been very, very high. Did you see that story?
Yeah, absolutely. The black vote in the, I should know this off the top of my head, in the general election was like 96% for Warnock. I mean, it was huge, like 3% for Herschel Walker.
Yes.
So the disparity was absolutely huge. And so you would expect the disparity to be just as huge this time. And I think, 33% of the early vote has been black, which has been a little more than representative of the percentage of black voters in the Georgia electorate. So, yeah, it's been a big, big deal, and it does appear to favor Warnock.
And that's a fact, and that people can take to the bank. But they can't take to the bank what I have sensed from the New York Times, the Washington Post, the mainstream media on CNN. I don't watch CNN anymore, but that Warnock is winning. And I think that's just voter suppression in their terms. What they would call voter suppression, I just think it's, okay, the left-wing media is being the left-wing media.
Well, let me ask you about the question of candidate quality.
Yes.
In my view, and just my observation, Warnock is not a very strong candidate. He's certainly been an undistinguished, nondescript senator. But Herschel Walker has not been a good candidate either. If you judge by coming out, giving a speech, and he's not terribly good at it. How do you view candidate quality in this race?
Herschel's a C-minus candidate because he doesn't know anything about politics.
C-minus.
C-minus. And the reason I give him a C-minus, an average candidate will arrive with briefing books, and they've done some study, and they've been around politics for a while. This is, to me, the overarching theme of 2022 is don't make your first run for office a statewide office unless you want to lose. Or unless you're Dave McCormick and you've successfully raised billions of dollars and you could have won Pennsylvania. But Dr. Oz, who's rich, just made some obvious, terrible, stupid mistakes, like the grocery store ad. And Herschel's made some obvious, terrible mistakes, and the Oppo research has just killed him. And Carrie Lake made obvious, stupid mistakes. First-time candidates do stupid things. It's like first-time radio host, Byron. And the first time anyone appears on the special report panel, they screw it up. I was talking to a rookie the other night about their first appearance, and they thought they screwed it up. Repetitions matter, muscle memory. What do you make of my explanation? Just first-time candidates are bad at this.
So you're saying that if Herschel Walker ran again, he would be a much, much better candidate?
No. He would have to present a much different work to prepare.
Well, he'd have to learn more about stuff.
Yes. You have to know the triad.
The thing about political campaigns, high-level political campaigns, is that they reveal your limitations brutally. And this happened with Scott Walker when he ran for president and was so admired by Republicans for standing up, for first of all, passing good legislation and sticking with it in Wisconsin, and then standing up to the attempts of the left to just kill him over and over again, was highly respected. But when he got onto the national stage, he really hadn't thought through a lot of the issues involved. And a campaign is no place to learn that. You can't.
Although I will say this, Governor Walker, who's a friend of mine, so I want to be very careful to point that out so people know it's not an even playing field. Governor Walker is shorter than everybody else on that debate stage. He had a big bald spot, and he was overshadowed by the Trump Jeb knockdown. And he very quickly decided, I am getting out of this roller derby. And so he just figured out that all the rules were off. Right? It was like a cage match, and they were throwing chairs, and he said, I'm not doing this, and he got out of there.
If Herschel Walker loses, I want to hear your explanation for this.
Oh, Herschel, I don't want to make it Herschel specific.
Does he have a bald spot? I don't know.
I just had a lot of takes on that from the debate side. Byron, you and I do nothing but 24/7 study politics, government, and public policy. And you can't put in what God left out, and you can't make up in lost time by prepping with a briefing book. You have to breathe in this stuff, right? And so when I run down Donald Trump, Greg Abbott, Chris Christie, Ron DeSantis, Nikki Haley, Larry Hogan, Asa Hutchinson, Kristi Noem, Mike Pence, Marco Rubio, Rick Scott, Tim Scott, Chris Sununu, Glenn Youngkin, and not Tom Cotton and not Doug Ducey because they've dropped out, you and I could talk about any of those people without preparation, right?
Yes, a lot of experience there.
It's like knowing football. I listen to the Buckeye Talk podcast, and I'm astonished when Doug LaMaurice says, the 2006 Buckeyes were a lot like the 2022 team. I said, what the hell? How do you know that? It's because he covered the Buckeyes for 17 years. And that's what first-time candidates don't know. I it's not a rap on them. It's just they just don't know.
So in the Senate, obviously J.D. Vance won. Is he the only one on the Republican side?
Yes, and J.D. Vance, of course, wrote the book, Learn Media, has been around the high finance world, and is really, really smart. Book smart, right? Yale Law School, book smart. So that he can actually study up and get it right. And I did the first Ohio Senate debate. Bernie Marino's the same way, so is Matt Dolan. They know it. So let me ask you the question I asked Drucker. Some years in the future, Donald Trump will die. He is not invincible and invulnerable. I may predecease him, so I want to get this on the record early. He will lie in state in the rotunda. How big will the crowds be, Byron York?
I heard the question to Drucker, and I was glad I didn't get it first, so you don't have the element of surprise on me like you did with David. I think they'll be huge, maybe this is... inappropriate, but there was a big crowd at January 6th. I mean, a lot of people come around from around the country to show their support, reverence, et cetera, for Donald Trump, I think.
And what does that tell you about his presidential campaign, if anything?
It doesn't tell you anything about his presidential campaign. It doesn't tell you anything. I mean, I was just looking at the numbers yesterday in this new Marquette poll, and, he can always... count on about a third of the electorate.
That's it.
And that can give you a really big crowd, but it will never win you a presidential election.
That's what Nixon said when he was running in 68, and he told me when I was working for him, you can't win without the Goldwater people, but you can't win with just the Goldwater people. It's the same thing about the Trump people. Byron York, I wish I'd surprised you first with that, but it's going to be huge. And people need to remember that when they wonder about whether Donald Trump will do well in these primaries. Thank you, Byron. Follow him at Byron York Online. Follow me to the next segment here live on the Hugh Hewitt Show from the Beltway. Stay tuned. Welcome back, America. It's the Christmas season. We got 19 days left until Christmas. I hope you've done your shopping. The folks at Prison Fellowship who run Angel Tree are out there busy shopping for the 1.5 million children who have parents incarcerated. Now, they won't get to all 1.5 million because that would require $30 million and Angel Tree contributors. But we're trying to take care of one child at a time, all right? Save one starfish on the shore. Better than not saving any of them. Connecting a child with their mom or dad who's incarcerated at Christmas time means the world to them. It means the world to us that you help us do that. I'd like you to listen to Michael, if you can. Michael, he and his sister grew up without their dad, who was, of course, in prison. And here's what he wants to say about Angel Tree.
Angel Tree's been in our lives for as long as we've been alive. Every year, we will receive a Christmas present from Dad with his writing and stuff. That's all done through Angel Tree. They'll ask him what we want, then confirm it with our mom, and then we'll get a present. A few days before, we'll get the present, and I'll call in, and we'll actually open it with him on the phone so we can kind of share the experience.
Okay, so that is staying in touch with your dad, who's incarcerated. Doesn't matter why. It could be any kind of crime. You don't know why people are in jail. It can be something completely nonviolent, like tax fraud, and it can be something extremely controversial, like Jared Kushner's dad, and he writes about the burden of Charles Kushner being in jail all those years in his memoir. It can be anything. But as a Christian, and I would think all of you who are participating in Christmas as a religious observation know that what you do to the least of these you have done to me, and that what you do for the children of prisoners is very much like visiting the prisoner in jail or welcoming the stranger. And that contribution helps. Over at HughHewitt.com, the banner is at the very top of HughHewitt.com. The phone number is not on my list here. That didn't show up today. So I'm not going to give you a phone number. Just go to HughHewitt.com. $125 blesses five children. $125 is five different presents that's coming. Now, I also want to do a market report because Birch Gold is a sponsor of this show, and they are getting a lot of new customers. And I am not surprised that people are buying gold because they sense something is mighty wrong. And it's the combination of a recession, the Ukraine war, the China crackdown, the Iranian instability, and then the collapse of FTX and Bitcoin. And I've told you what John Ellis wrote in Ellis News Items this morning. There's a lot of off-the-book stuff having to do with FX that we just do not know. And FTX that we don't, which we do know. Yesterday, the Dow was off almost 500 points, almost a percentage and a half. NASDAQ was down almost 2%, and the S&P was down about almost 2%. So it's not one sector. It's not any, people are scared. They're freezing up. I've seen this before. I thought that we would just get through this with high interest rates. I don't know. I think the sell-off is pretty remarkable. Gold went down to 1785 yesterday after briefly going above 1800. It's at 1792 now. The 10-year Treasury is back at 3.6. If you're going to buy gold, do it from Birch Gold. Go to HughGold.com so you can trust the people you're dealing with. If you want to open up the long-term IRA, SEP IRA, 401k, or you want to roll over an existing one into a physical precious metals depository administered by a third-party agent, that's Birch Gold. It's accepted by the IRS. It's completely legit, long-standing, very, very well-respected group. You don't have to worry about squirrely people on the other end named, you know, Joe Bag of Donuts who wants to take your dough from you. No. Go to Birch Gold. Go to Hugh Gold. That's who I buy my gold from. It's delivered to my house. I put it in the deposit box. And if you have an IRA and you want to roll it over, they will put the depository together. Just go to HughGold.com, HughGold.com. Coming up after the break, I'm going to be talking with three senators, and I start my senator's rundown in the fourth segment today, Florida Senator Rick Scott. But I'd like to hear from voters in Georgia this morning, 1-800-520-1234. Georgia, get out and vote for Raphael Warnock, and call me and tell me if you did. Get out and vote for Herschel Walker. Gosh, it's been a long 2022 campaign season. Get out and vote for Herschel. My number is 1-800-520-1234. I want to talk to Georgians about what's going on the ground. 1-800-520-1234. Call me. Jacob is standing by. 1-800-520-1234. Georgia voters, tell me what you think on this election day in Georgia. Get out and vote for Herschel. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Curious about what you're missing in the universe? The After Show? 21 years of Hugh Hewitt shows on demand? Go to www.universe.com right now, where it's only 99 cents to join for the first month. www.universe.com.
You know, there are all kinds of interesting people that live right around your neighborhood, like, oh, the postman and the policeman.
Hey, did you order these groceries here?
Oh, hi there. Yes, as a matter of fact, I did.
Now, these are your groceries.
Have you got everything I ordered?
No.
How about the parsley?
No, we didn't have the parsley.
Oh, you didn't have the parsley.
No, we brought some other stuff instead, though.
What'd you bring instead?
Well, let's see. I brought some Brussels sprouts.
Brussels sprouts.
Yes, and
all
I got
right.
some turnip greens.
Turnip greens,
I got
yes.
some kale.
Kale?
Yes, we were having a big sale on kale.
Oh, a big kale sale.
You've heard about it.
I've heard about it.
Yes, indeed. Well, I brought you a lot of that.
Hey, listen, I was just talking about some of the people that lived around our neighborhood. And,
you were?
Yeah.
What'd
you say? Long as you look sort of like, well, you know, a grocer, one of those people around the neighborhood, why don't we do that song about the people in your neighborhood?
Well, I'd rather not, actually.
Oh, come on. It's a nice song.
Well, okay, but you start off.
All right, I'll start off. Well, now... Who are the people in your neighborhood? In your neighborhood? In your neighborhood? Say, who are the people in your neighborhood? The people that you meet each day. As long as you look like the grocer, why don't you tell us what a grocer does?
Okay.
All right?
Oh, a grocer sells the things you eat, like cereal and cheese and meat. Whatever food you're looking for, you're sure to find it in my store.
Because hey, the grocer is it. A person in your
and my kids never got to listen to Bob McGrath.
He's in your name.
They never got to hear him. Because the two older kids said to the youngest one, we're not watching that show, that's a baby show. The Fetching Mrs. Hewitt and I love Bob McGrath. We love Sesame Street. We love Maria. We loved everyone on Sesame Street because our first two children love Sesame Street. It's just the third one I never got to watch it because the other two were tyrants. Bob McGrath, founding Sesame Street cast member, died on Monday at the age of 90. Might have been Sunday night late. I saw that news and it's very sad. It's not sad. He had a great life. He made a lot of people happy. He made a lot of people smile. He contributed a lot to the education of young children who are trapped in hotels and things like that. Sesame Street was a companion to many parents and to millions of children. Bob McGrath, RIP, also lost. Well, I let me go to the phone. Ron in Georgia, where it is a little bit rainy in Atlanta, cloudy all day in the high 50s and low 60s. Have you voted yet? Ron.
Mr. Hewitt, good morning. I voted. Yes, I did. It's 45 degrees, and it's raining all day, and I voted.
Did you vote this morning?
Yes, I voted about 15 minutes ago, as soon as the polls opened, 20 minutes ago.
And who did you vote for?
Well, I can always say my wife and I'd rather vote for Rock than Warnock, but I voted for Herschel.
Good for you. Now, tell me about how you feel about the race.
Well, I feel like your sentiment was the other day. It's just a seat. Nobody really cares. We're just trying to keep a seat.
That's
in
it.
In other words,
RD.
If I need an engine change in my car, neither one of them can do it, but I have to pick between one of them.
Yep. RD. That's what it is. And how do you feel? Do you think Herschel is winning, losing, or tied?
I don't think Herschel's going to make it. I think he should stay with his Heisman Trophy, and we'll see what happens.
I think that's generally the view, but do you think there's a chance?
I think there's a chance. There's always a chance, to run off, so there's a chance, right?
You're doing basically so you're telling me there's a chance bit. I think it's better than you think, but we'll find out. Thank you, friend. Mark in Georgia, what do you think, Mark?
Good morning, Mr. Hewitt.
Good morning.
I just finished voting about 10 minutes ago when the polls opened. It was a nice line outside. Even though it is still like it's going to be raining most of the day, and I voted for Herschel Walker.
You're in Atlanta.
I am in North Fulton County, Roswell.
Okay. Now, the reason are you African American?
I am African American.
You know that the black vote was very low for Herschel in the first round. Do you think that's changed at all?
I think it may be a little bit more that are going to vote for Herschel. I'm thinking he may get a few more votes.
Why?
Why? Because I think there are a lot of people who realize how important this seat is, and I think they may say to the pollsters, I'm voting for Warnock, but I think when they get in that booth, I think they may vote for Herschel.
Do you feel optimistic, pessimistic, or you don't know?
I think Herschel, he pulls across. I think we're going to know tonight, and I think the high turnout with the number of Republican voters that have been registered here in Georgia, I think that there's going to be enough of a turnout, especially with Kemp's his ground game joining in with Herschel to get people out. I think that a high turnout is actually going to be to Herschel's advantage. I don't think.
Oh, absolutely. An election day turnout favors Herschel. We learned that on the general. It's just whether or not the early vote, which is large, precluded it. And that's what legacy media is trying to suggest, but I just don't know if it's true. Hey, Mark, thank you. I want to go to Marvin now in Georgia. What do you think, Marvin? Did you vote this morning?
No, I did not vote this morning. I voted early voting last Tuesday.
And who'd you vote for?
Oh, well, Herschel.
And how do you feel about it?
I was just listening in to what you were saying. I'm in the Atlanta area. I'm on the road right now. Knew I was going to be. That's why I had to vote early. I'm kind of a little concerned about Herschel and all of this, but I voted that away Republican. I've lived in the Atlanta area for the last 40-some-odd years, never in Atlanta, but in the surrounding counties.
And so what's your prediction?
God, I don't know. All the polls and stuff showing the other way, I don't quite understand the concept of the push for the early voting. If things are like they should be, I don't know. I don't understand why it would make such a big difference. If early voting indicates some kind of shenanigans going on with the voting, then I can understand that.
No, it doesn't. It does not. There is no shenanigans. Brian, Governor Kemp's got that under control. I just think that the early vote is because a lot of people say it's December and it's Christmas and I don't want to vote on election day. I don't know where I'm going to be doing. So we will see tonight. Hey, thank you, Marvin. Jonathan in Georgia. What do you think, Jonathan?
Early turnout this morning. I'm no pollster, but I'm street savvy. It appears to me, I'm around the Augusta area, by the way, the second largest city in the state. It appears to me blue collar vote, Walker voters. I mean, the looks could be deceiving. But I just think people see through the media bias, and it looks like to me they understand that they can see through all the clutter with the big money coming in. I actually think with the Bulldog football team doing hot, I know you don't like to hear that, Hugh.
Well, we're going to beat you.
Bulldog voters,
we're going to beat you on December 31st. You know that, don't you? Buckeyes are going to put the hurt on you.
Well, you're faithful. That's all I can say, Hugh, and I admire that, but good luck.
Thank you, friend. I was booking Coach Meyer for an interview later in the month, and we were talking about the game. And yesterday's Buckeye Talk said, in front of the Buckeyes is college football legend. To lose the game in the house, in the shoe, and then come back from the dead because the USC Trojans fell apart, to go and take out number one Georgia and then to beat Michigan, which I'm sorry, is just going to hammer TCU, which should not be in there. TCU is going to get out of the way. The Buckeyes are going to upset the Bulldogs. And then they're going to match up at SoFi Stadium on January 9th. And somebody better invite me to that game. David in Georgia, what do you think, David?
Hey, good morning, Hugh. I did get out and vote this morning, out in the rain with my umbrella. So it was a pretty good turnout at our precinct. I was pleasantly surprised about that.
And it's going to clear up later in the day, so people might be waiting for the rain to stop. Did you vote for Herschel?
I did.
Okay, based on everything you've seen, read, and heard, do you think he has a shot? Is he behind? Is he ahead? Is it tied?
I think he definitely has a
shot. He dropped. He was saying.
I think he's got a shot, but boy, I tell you, Hugh, they spent a lot of money dragging him through the mud.
Oh, my goodness. You're telling me. Oh, did they spend money dragging Herschel. Thank you, David. Jeremy, last call. What do you see? What do you feel?
I'm on the way now to go vote. I feel like Herschel does have a chance, but I agree with the last caller. There's been a lot of money poured into South Georgia in the advertisements slinging him through the mud.
Do you know the one place where Herschel has outspent them is in the Tallahassee media market, which reaches into southern Georgia? Otherwise, you've been swamped. But it's interesting to me
I'm
that...
I'm surprised by that because all I see on all the networks and even on the streaming services, it's just all Warnock.
And so, what do you feel?
I feel that I'm going to vote for Urschel for the seat, like a lot of other people are. Do I think he's a great candidate? No. I really
that
don't.
Is, I believe, by the way, that's widespread. I love the guy. I love sitting down with him. I don't think he's been a very good candidate because he's a first-time candidate, and they never are. But I think he is a beloved figure, and I think he's going to pull it out. But I don't know. I don't know. It's very close, and I am impacted by legacy media bias because that's all I read to prepare for the show. And they just all want Raphael Warnock to beat Herschel so they can mock Trump. I mean, it's just so simple that legacy media wants Herschel Walker to lose so they can mock Trump. That's all that's about. Hey, Jeremy, thank you. Speaking about encouraging as opposed to mocking, I want to encourage Generalissimo, who is my PhD, weightloss.com spokesperson on the Hugh Hewitt Show, because I didn't need to lose 50 pounds. And I want to encourage him not to, you know, he just let the pedal off the metal.
No, he
ballooning.
Hasn't.
He went from
ballooning.
190 to 191 and a half.
Yeah.
Right?
So I've gained less than 1% of my ideal target weight. And
I'm just saying, ballooning? You've gone from 190 to 191 and a half. If you extrapolate that every week, you'll be back up to 250 in no time.
No, wrong. I lost my 50 pounds. I may have gained a pound.
You're finding it.
Over a month, maybe.
I'm just saying... If you don't have the commitment, you know, it's not the size of the dog in the fight, it's the size of the fight in the dog. Not the size of the fiddle in the band, it's the tune it plays.
Have you maintained the same ounce every day for...
No, I just go lower. Whenever I hit 185, I go lower.
But
it's a warning signal.
Okay, but then you get back up to 185, don't you?
No, I stay at one. I below 185 is my goal, and if it ever touches 185, I immediately begin fasting.
Has it
again.
Touched 185?
No, I'm very observant.
Oh, I see.
MyPhDWeightLoss.com. It actually works very well, and Generalissimo is in the maintenance phase. How long have you been in maintenance?
How long have I been in maintenance? About a month.
A month. And you're at 1.5 pounds over your 50-pound weight gain?
All I need to stay is within five.
I'm just saying it works.
Yes.
864-644-1900. 864-644-1900. Thank you. All right. ReliefFactor.com. Where did I put my ReliefFactor.com bag? It's right over here. And as you can see, taking it right there this morning. Open it up. Got my four pills. Going to go out afterward. I don't know if it's raining. It was raining a little bit earlier, but it was just a little drizzle. So I don't know if it's going to be raining when the show's over. I keep the studio shutters closed and the drapes drawn so that all this wonderful ambient lighting isn't interfered with. Can you see the nutcracker, by the way, behind my head? That's because when Len Kornikowski excerpted this yesterday, we couldn't see the nutcracker and the ribbon. So I moved the ribbon down below. Did the ribbon fall off? Can you see the ribbon? I cannot get these Christmas decorations to be Christmassy. ReliefFactor.com. If you're doing Christmas shopping or you are lifting the Christmas tree and you hurt your back, then you want to go and get ReliefFactor.com for yourself for Christmas. $19.95 is the 3-week starter pack. Millions of people have now tried it. I mean, they're all over because people are figuring out these are the four supplements I need to take every single day. ReliefFactor.com. The starter pack is $19.95. Go sign up for it. Take it every day like I just did on air live from the Beltway. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
We'll be right back.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, joined by Florida Senator Rick Scott, chairman of the National Republican Senatorial Committee, probably on the ground in Georgia. I'm not sure. Good morning, Senator Scott. Where do we find you today?
Well, I've got to be in D.C. We're voting today. So, but I've been with Herschel about once a week, and I talk to him almost every day. He's excited. He believes he's going to have a big win. The key is going to be our turnout if people are energized to vote. I mean, I say the simple as this. When are you finally going to show up because you're sick and tired of inflation and high crime? You're sick and tired of a woke military. You're sick and tired of the Afghanistan withdrawal. You're sick and tired about being lied by the Democrats. So I think everything I'm hearing, and I got the text this morning from one of the individuals that does our outbound phone call in to get voters out. He says there's a lot of energy on Herschel's side. He needs to have a good turnout today because it's still at this point, we have more of our voters wanting to vote on election day, and we've got to vote. If you have the opportunity to vote by mail, vote by mail. If you have the opportunity to vote in person early, vote early. Make sure that way nothing will happen on election day that will prevent you from voting. So far, Democrats are doing a better job than that than we are, but I think Herschel's going to win. He's optimistic. I was with him on Friday at a big rally. He has big rallies every day, so if those turn into votes, he's going to have a win.
Now, Senator Scott, I talked to both David Drucker and Byron York, and the latter agreed with me, and the former didn't, that I think legacy media, left-leaning big media, is trying to tell Georgia voters it's over, and it's not. Herschel, it's a dead heat as far as I can tell. Am I right, or is...
Yeah, the polls that we've seen, in the last poll I had, 48-48. And so it's really... But it's like this, you know, Hugh, here's the way this works. It doesn't matter what the polls say. Right now it's tied, but it doesn't matter. Who's going to vote? How important is this election to you? If you care about, you know, the direction of this country, and people think that we're heading the wrong direction, and you show up to vote. I was at a dinner the other night, and everybody there was complaining like crazy. I said, how many of you donated? How many of you run for office? How many of you volunteer? Okay. And they all vote. But I said, if this is so bad, you got to start doing more. I said, you don't have to run for office, but you got to go help people win these seats.
Now, Governor Brian Kemp is all in for Herschel. He's doing everything he can. He won by eight points. Yeah, he won by eight points.
I mean, Governor Kemp has done, he's done ads, he's done rallies, he's done fundraising, he's done everything he can to help Herschel because he knows he needs a partner in D.C. So, no, Governor Kemp has done everything he can to be helpful to Herschel to make sure he wins. Herschel should win, but it's all tied to you have to go vote. Yeah. You can't sit there and say, oh, yeah, I'm sick and tired of this stuff, but I don't go vote. You need to go vote, make sure your family members are voting, your friends are voting, and you've got to get the vote out.
I've told everyone, J.D. Vance won, but we lost Pennsylvania, so it's a 50-50 Senate. And if Herschel wins, and then what's the difference between 51-49 and 50-50? I said it's a lot. Would you explain it?
Sure. The biggest thing is all committees will have the same number of Republicans or Democrats. So every legislation and every nomination has to have at least Republican form, or they won't get through the committee. It's very important that we get a 50-50 Senate because these committees. Legislation comes up through committees, nominees come up through committees. And so if you want to make sure Republicans are part of the conversation, then you got to get Herschel to win. If you don't live in Georgia, call your friends in Georgia. Say, look, it's important to me that you go vote for Herschel Walker.
I agree. And I've been telling people that. And Georgia, I cover Georgia. And I was just talking to a fellow who's down in my Macon audience, and he's all gone. It's raining a little bit in Georgia. They got to get out. They got to stand in line. How long? I think the polls are open till 8. I don't know when we'll know this, and I am very leery of calls, early calls. But, Senator Scott, I want to change subjects on you very briefly. When will you decide whether you, Rick Scott, are going to run for president or not?
I'm running for re-election as a senator from the great state of Florida. I will work my butt off over the next 2 years for my reelection. But the truth is, you sort of do it every day by doing your job. And so that's my job is to represent my state. And that's what I do every day. And that's what I'll continue to do.
Are you ruling out a run for president?
I'm focused on the Senate. Right.
Yeah, come on, Senator, help me out here a little bit. I got to make a little news. Are you saying no, not now, never, or are you saying, ah, we'll see?
I think I'm saying the same thing. I'm not. What I'm saying is I have no plan to run for president. I have a 100% plan to run for the U.S. Senate.
But you're not ruling it out.
Well, I mean, I'm not going to do it. I mean, I'm running for Senate. I'm running for my job as a U.S. Senator. I like.
I hear you. I hear you. But I think I am interpreting that as no, not now, never. And I just don't want to misunderstand you.
No, I'm running for the Senate.
All right. Senator Rick Scott, thank you for all the work that you've done for the last 2 years. It's been incredible and unusual cycle this year, but J.D. came through, and I'm glad you helped him across the finish line. Not one Republican incumbent was defeated, and Rick Scott was the chair of the National Republican Senatorial Committee, and he's urging you to get out for vote for Herschel, as I am. Go and vote, Georgia. I cover the state. We need you. It could be a one-vote race. Really, we could be in recount territory. Get out there and vote. Thank you, Senator Scott. I'll be back. Hour number three, Senator Cotton, Senator Sullivan, coming up here on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of The Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by PhD Weight Loss and Nutrition. Go to myphdweightloss.com to learn more.
Morning, Glory America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt live inside the Beltway, joined by Alaska Senator Dan Sullivan. Good morning, Senator Sullivan. How go you this morning?
Good morning, Hugh. I'm doing great. Merry Christmas, and I hope you and your family are doing well as well.
We are, and the Browns are even a little bit better, and the Ohio State Buckeyes have been resurrected, so I like that too. Senator,
well, you know what? I wanted to mention, I know you and I love football. I am actually going to the greatest game, in my view, of the year. It's a little underrated. I go every year with my dad, a Navy veteran, my brother Sean, a bunch of my siblings. Army-Navy this weekend. It's going to be awesome. Best game.
Go Navy, beat Army.
Go Navy, beat Army. I love that.
My son will be there. My son-in-law can't make it this year, both active duty Navy, and we are very, very pro-Navy here. You're right. Go Navy, beat Army, but I'm glad. I've only been once. It's quite the spectacle.
Oh, you got to go. You need to go. Come with me. I go every year. Unfortunately, my dad passed away 2 years ago. It's the greatest sporting event in America. Anytime you want to come, I'll be there. So
thank you, Senator. Now I want to cover three things with you. Georgia and Herschel, yeah. And the difference of 50-50 Senate makes to 51-49. Number two, the deal that President Biden is supposed to be doing in Alaska, and then I want to talk about the Chi-Coms and what I'm afraid is going to be another Tiananmen Square. Let's start with Georgia. People are voting as we speak. They're standing in line. It's raining a little bit. How important is it that Herschel win?
So important. And, you know, like a lot of my fellow Republican senators, I campaigned all over the country to help candidates this fall. It was disappointing. We know that we didn't take the majority, but as you just mentioned, being 50-50 is way more important for us, for America, than being 51-49. And it's all about power in the Senate. And it sounds technical, but let me just give you one example. If we're 50-50, then every committee in the U.S. Senate is split evenly. That gives us way more power if we don't have a split in the committees. And so that's just one of many examples where we can do a lot more to prevent Biden's radical nominees becoming confirmed by the Senate, radical legislation. It makes it much harder for them to implement their radical anti-American agenda if we're 50-50.
Okay, that's a reason enough, Georgia, to get out there and vote and stand in line, even if it's raining. Second,
and we know people in Georgia; they've had a lot of elections over the last couple of years. We know it. We appreciate all that you've done, but please get out there and vote for Herschel.
One more time, get it one more time, then you can rest for 2 years, and you will not be bombarded. In fact, 2 years from now, I don't think anyone's up. Senator Sullivan, let's talk now about Alaska and oil drilling. President Biden and his team keep going out and saying there are thousands and thousands of unused permits. Is he actually obstructing oil and gas development in Alaska?
110%, Hugh. That's 110%. Look, there are a lot of Biden policy disasters, but his energy policy is the biggest disaster of them all from day one. And I've seen this not just in America, but expressly in Alaska. They have focused on shutting down or delaying production of American energy, shutting down or killing American energy infrastructure, going to American banks and financial institutions, and believe it or not, pressuring them not to invest in the American energy sector. And then you see what they do. They go bend the knee. Literally, the president of the United States bent the knee in Saudi Arabia, embarrassing as hell for our country, and bend the knee to dictators to produce more oil. I mean, it is unbelievable. You saw what they just did with Venezuela. But in Alaska, you know, we got Anwar passed, right? Into law, two lease sales mandated by the Congress. Day one, the president suspended those. You can't suspend those, right? That's in the law. The president's job is to faithfully execute the laws of our nation, not to block them. And then now we have this incredible project called the Willow Project. It has been in permitting, if you can believe this, Hugh, for almost 20 years. It's in the National Petroleum Reserve of Alaska. It is ready to go. If the Biden administration gives the green light on this, it will produce over 2,500 jobs, and it's peak production, Willow will produce 190,000 barrels a day, and they're delaying it. They're greenlighting Venezuela, and they're delaying the Willow Project. Every one of your listeners should call these guys saying, let the Willow Project and American energy, American workers. And by the way, the Willow Project is the most environmentally responsible, sensitive major oil and gas project on the planet Earth. Lowest greenhouse gas emissions of any major project in the world. Meanwhile, Venezuela, 18 times more polluting than the average American energy project. This is the definition of policy insanity.
So, Senator, when you hear the president say, we've given thousands of permits that the oil and gas industry isn't using, they should use those first, or you hear Corrine doing that at the White House, what should the follow-up question be to focus folks on the facts of their obstruction as opposed to their talking point deflection?
Let me give you three. First, Mr. President, approve the Willow Project, almost 200,000 barrels a day. I pressed the President of the United States directly on this project 18 months ago. Directly. I even gave him a memo on it. He said he wasn't aware of it, which I believe. He's not aware of a lot of things. And 2 days later, his White House called me saying, the President's going to support Willow. Okay? End of story. When I worked for George W. Bush, if the President of the United States told two U.S. senators and a congressman he was going to do something, that was it. So number one, approve Willow. That's America. That's the biggest American energy project in the country right now, ready to go, been in permitting for almost 20 years. Secondly, this president has put out the lowest amount of leases since any president since World War II. That is a fact. And the third one they should be pressed on. Now, this is a little more technical, but it's in the energy sector. There are things, these aren't just the leases. There are these things, once you get a lease, are called applications to drill. Okay, that's actually the real thing that needs to be approved. There are 8,000 applications to drill, including in Alaska, that this administration is sitting on. That's how you get production going. The applications to drill.
Yeah, I knew that, but sitting on. We needed the specifics. Now, before we run out of time, I want to ask you about the Chi-Coms. You signed a letter, I believe you authored it, and you got 41 co-signers, to the Chinese ambassador warning them against a Tiananmen Square repeat. Did you get an answer, Senator?
They said they were going to give us an answer within a couple hours. We haven't gotten any answer for that yet. But, Ambassador, if you're listening or any other Communist Party, we want an answer, right? We want an answer. Our letter was very simple. By the way, almost half the Senate, including a lot of Dems, signed on to my letter, and it essentially just said, we're watching very closely these historic protests. Last time you had protests of this magnitude, you undertook a violent crackdown, 1989, Tiananmen Square, that killed hundreds, if not thousands, of peacefully protesting students, and we cautioned the Chinese Communist Party in the strongest possible terms not to kill your people again simply because they want more freedom. You know, Hugh, this goes exactly to the biggest vulnerability Xi Jinping has, and it's this. These guys fear their own people. They fear their own people, and we need to exploit that vulnerability every opportunity we can.
Okay, Senator, I talked to Len Khodorkovsky yesterday about the cracks in the Iranian regime's ability to hold their people down. They are forming. They're spider-like. Do you think that regime is close to tumbling?
Not yet. Not yet, but it's the same issue. The
right.
Terrorist regime in Iran, the biggest thing they fear is their own people. And it's the same thing we need to be doing with regard to China. When the protesters take to the streets, these brave Iranian women, I mean, you want to talk about courage? When they take to the streets, the United States needs to lift its voice in support of these kind of heroes, in my view. That was the purpose of the letter we sent to the Chinese Communist Party. I thought that world leaders' response to the protests in Beijing and throughout China, to the protests in Iran, have been much too tepid, including from Joe Biden. World leaders need to speak up and actually show support for these brave people who are pushing for freedom. That was the point of our letter to the Chinese Communist Party, and we need to do it in Iran. So to answer your question, I don't think it's cracking yet, but you never know, and we need to support them.
Last question, Senator, completely political. Any chance you run for president in 2024?
No.
Okay. Yeah, you see, sometimes people like you and Cotton say no, and other people like Senator Scott say, I'm running for Senate in Florida, which isn't a no. You're a no. Am I clear on that?
No,
you're
but
a no.
What we need to do is we need to make sure that we have a Republican president, because every one of these policies we just talked about, Hugh, a Republican president would promote. Joe Biden's undermining him.
I appreciate that, and I also appreciate clarity. Thank you, Senator. You know, he's a great Ohioan, but he's also an Alaskan. He's been in Alaska forever. Senator Dan Sullivan, Browns fan, Buckeyes fan, and, of course, a fan of freedom and energy production in his home state of Alaska. Stay tuned, America. Lots more ahead on The Hugh Hewitt Show. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. John Kennedy, senator from Louisiana, was down campaigning with Herschel yesterday, and he said this, cut number two.
So I want you to go vote. I want you to go vote. Did I mention I want you to go vote? Look at it this way, folks. If dead people can do it, so can you.
John Kennedy is a funny guy. All right, he's a funny guy. But it's not funny. I mean, this matters a lot, Georgia. I know it's raining in parts of Atlanta. Go stand in line. Take an umbrella. Get out and vote. It's close. Don't believe the legacy media saying Raphael Warnock's just won it in early voting. That's nonsense. Republicans vote on Election Day in much larger numbers than Democrats. Get out and blow them away. Because then we can talk about it for years, about how they tried to give this election to Raphael Warnock. Let me also tell you about AndrewandTodd.com. They are great, great sponsors of the show. If you're going to buy a home because you're tired of crypto falling apart and you cannot, you just don't trust anything that you can't touch, feel, and see in your first investment, make it a house. If you're going to buy a house, interest rates dropped yesterday. They've dropped for about a week. Call Andrew and Todd at 888-888-1172 or go to AndrewandTodd.com. Answer a couple of questions. I'll be right back to you. You know, now is the time. Do not wait. Don't say, oh, you know what? House prices are going to fall. No, they are not. Interest rates are going to go up. The Fed is going to raise it a little bit less than we thought in December, a half point. But they're going to go up at their meeting next week, and interest rates will rise. And then next year, they're going to have to keep raising them. So it's not going to get better. It's going to get worse, and you're going to miss the equity appreciation. It's not slowing down. The number of houses on the market is fewer. And the frenzy has died down, but the demand has not died down. And if you were disappointed, you tried to buy a house again and again and again, and you were unsuccessful, now is the time to shop at the Christmas season. But get pre-qualified at AndrewandTodd.com. 888-888-1172. Now let me tell you about something I'm starting new today. GOP news, only available on the universe. Not going to be in the podcast, not going to be on the show. I understand that not all of you are as interested in GOP news as I am. That's my sweet spot. I know who's running for president. I know their teams. I know the consultants. It's my sweet spot. So beginning today, after the 2022 election show is over, and it's over for me today, I'm not doing a special broadcast tonight. Larry O'Connor on the Salem News Channel will give you early returns tonight. I am simply going to start doing, after the show is over, for those of you who are obsessed with GOP news, if you join the universe, you will hear every day my take on. And I've got, how many stories I've got here on GOP news? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 GOP news stories. But it's only GOP news. And the big ones, like when Donald Trump calls for the repeal of the Constitution, I cover that on the show. But there's little stuff that goes into the campaigning today. You know, little stuff like a story in the Hill on Josh Hawley and Marco Rubio and Ted Cruz trying to take away GOP populism votes from Donald Trump. That may not interest a general radio audience. That might be too in the weeds. So you want in the weeds on the GOP news. You want to know who's running against Ronna McDaniel for GOP chairwoman. You want to know any of that stuff? Then you just got to subscribe to the universe. And it's cheap. I don't know what. You also get the after show, which is Generalissimo at 8 p.m. in the East, 5 in the West. You get a whole bunch of stuff. Every Hugh Hewitt show, you get this show commercial free every day. But you've got to load it, you've got to buy it, you've got to subscribe to it. And I've said I'm going to sit down and do extra programming because some of you want more and you want to go in depth. And a lot of you are radio news people. You just want to know what's going on in the world today. You want to hear from callers. You want to know about Georgia weather, stuff like that. I am happy to bring that to you every single morning for 3 hours. But if you want highly concentrated you and GOP news, then you've got to stick around and join the universe. Now, would you please call this number if you want to donate to Prison Fellowship Angel Tree Outreach. 888-206-2764. I did not have that in hour one when I was begging you, please. Listen to Michael talk about what this has meant to him for all of his days.
Angel Tree's been in our lives for as long as we've been alive. Every year we will receive a Christmas present from Dad with his writing and stuff. That's all done through Angel Tree. They'll ask him what we want, then confirm it with our mom, and then we'll get a present. A few days before, we'll get the present, and I'll call in, and we'll actually open it with him on the phone so we can kind of share the experience.
The Prison Fellowship banner is at the top of HughHewitt.com. $25 takes care of a child from age 1 to 18 through prison fellowship. They get a Bible, a present, and a note from mom or dad. And they sometimes get that call that Michael just talked about. Or call 888-206-2764 or the banner at HughHewitt.com. 888-206-2764. Welcome back, America. We're playing ships because it's Go Navy Beat Army Week. And we already heard Senator Dan Sullivan say Go Navy Beat Army, but we have to have some equal time here for the Army. Senator Tom Cotton is a proud Army veteran. Good morning, Senator. Welcome to the Hugh Hewitt Show. What say you about the game?
Good morning, Hugh. It's good to be on with you. I am an Army veteran. They're not a West Point veteran, so it's not quite as central to my life as it may be to some, but wish the cadets well. Wish the midshipmen well, of course, too, but I want the Army to win. And I guess congratulations are in order to you as well as I'm talking about college football. Your Buckeyes backed into the playoffs by USC losing. It couldn't have been a better weekend for Hugh Hewitt.
It couldn't have been. In fact, Easter came before Christmas this year as the Buckeyes were resurrected. That's the opening line of my second column this week for the Post. Senator, let me ask you about something I asked Rick Scott about earlier. You and Dan Sullivan both told me flat out you're not running for president. Senator Scott wouldn't say no. I'm not going to ask you about Senator Scott, but I'm going to start my GOP News special edition today. Because 2022 finally, in fact, let's go there first. 2022 ends today with the Georgia runoff. How important is it that Herschel win?
Well, it's incredibly important to you for the people of Georgia, irrespective of who controls the Senate in January and in the future. For the next 6 years, the person who wins today is going to be Georgians' voice in the Senate. I think Georgians want a voice for fiscal sanity, stable prices, low taxes, tough on crime policies, a secure border, and strong national defense. And Herschel Walker will give it to them. Raphael Warnock won. So if you're listening anywhere across Georgia today and you haven't voted, please make sure to get out the polls and pull the lever for Herschel Walker. In terms of control of the Senate, it makes a real big difference. I mean, there's lots of procedural things I could go into, but I'll just put it this way. At 50-50, it only takes one Democrat to defect on bad laws or especially bad nominees. And there have been plenty of really radical nominees that we've stopped because this or that Democrat declined to go along with them. Sometimes it's happened in private and hasn't been reported publicly. But trying to get two Democrats to defect on the same nominee or the same legislative measure, that's a horse of a different color. So it matters first and foremost for the people of Georgia for the next 6 years, but it certainly matters in terms of the country and total control of the Senate in the hands of Chuck Schumer for the next 2 years.
Now, Senator Cotton, my next question goes to GOP News. It's a new feature I'm starting for the Universe today. I'm unclear. Do you listen to the podcast or do you listen to the Universe, Senator?
I listen to your podcast, Hugh.
Okay, so you missed most of the show. We got out, and you're gonna miss the GOP News, which is gonna follow the live show every day, but only for Universe subscribers, because there's too much GOP News every day. I've got a list here: former President Trump, who's declared, and then not declared, and probably running: Greg Abbott, Chris Christie, Ted Cruz, Ron DeSantis, Nikki Haley, Larry Hogan, Asa Hutchinson, Kristi Noem, Mike Pence, Marco Rubio, Rick Scott, Tim Scott, Chris Sununu, Glenn Youngkin. And then I have not running, Tom Cotton and Doug Ducey. When you've got the not running, when the not running list is two and the maybe running list is like 20, I'm just curious. Did I forget anyone when I ran down that list?
Hugh, it's hard to imagine that you forgot anyone, given how quickly you ran through a very long list of names, many of whom I consider friends, all of whom are accomplished leaders in their own right. I'm sure that plenty of those will run. Some probably will not. You know, Ann and I decided to close the chapter on 2024. Because our boys are just not at a good age for this. You know, 5 and 7, it's just a tough time to be on the road 6 or 7 days a week. We're not necessarily closing the book for all time in the future, but right now I'm going to continue my work in the United States Senate, which I'm very grateful to people of Arkansas let me do. And I wish all those people well, and I'm sure our voters will be able to pick a highly capable nominee, but I'm also sure that my boys can't find another dad for the next 2 years either.
And I respect that. And I can speak GOP. And that one, actually, most people can be trilingual and understand. You're saying, no, I'm not running. And Doug Ducey has said, no, I'm not running. So I speak GOP. But I had Senator Rick Scott on earlier today, and I asked him the same question. Well, I asked Dan Sullivan. He said, no, I'm not running. I asked Rick Scott, and he said, I'm running for senator in Florida. So does that rule out? He said, well, I'm running for senator. That's not a no, and therefore I speak GOP, and he's still on the margin there.
Again, I don't want to speak for any one person in particular. Everybody will take the time in the next few months to make their own decisions. I'll just say that having made my own Sherman-esque statement, I would assume that if someone doesn't make a Sherman-esque statement, it means they're at least not quite to the position where Sherman was of refusing the nomination if given and not running, if nominated, not serving if elected. So yeah, I assume anybody who doesn't simply say no is at least kicking the tires a little bit. And I like I said, I wish them all well. It's a big decision to make. And I hope they all take the time to reflect on it and make what's right for them, what's right for the country.
So, Senator, I love it when it's easier to talk to the people who've made Sherman S. statements and get them in a room than it is the people who haven't. So I'm talking to someone who's made a Sherman S. statement, and I want to talk to you about something that I'm writing about for the Post. I don't think that the RNC is thinking ahead well enough about how to get candidates onto platforms early to talk about the difference between Joe Biden, who I think is running for re-election, and the Republicans. First, do you think Joe Biden is running for re-election?
Hugh, I would assume he is, just because I assume that, you know, people who get elected president want to keep being president, and they run for re-election, as almost every modern president has. I know that his chief of staff last night, he said he expects to make that decision sometime after the holidays. So I assume we'd know in the next, you know, 4 or 5 weeks. But I would assume that he's running for re-election, yes.
And when I was on Special Report on Friday, and Brett suggested to me, hey, look, this new South Carolina primary must be good news for Kamala Harris. I said, it might be, but it's clear to me that that means Joe Biden is running because he didn't want to go up to New Hampshire and get Lyndon Johnson. He does not want to go to Iowa and get rejected again. He wants to go to South Carolina with Jim Clyburn, another old guy who's done well in South Carolina for a long time, and win again. Is that how you read the DNC shakeup of their primary calendar?
I can only imagine that the DNC trying to change the order of their elections is designed to benefit Joe Biden, who, of course, lost badly in both Iowa and New Hampshire. Now, I don't think it's necessarily a good thing for Kamala Harris, because remember, she ran such a poor campaign in 2019. She didn't even make it to the starting line in 2020, and that includes among the voters in Iowa and New Hampshire and South Carolina. She simply had no appeal anywhere. But I should also say, I don't think it's a foregone conclusion that any of these changes are going to happen the way Joe Biden proposed. You've already seen New Hampshire politicians, to include Democrats, saying they're not going to give up their first-in-the-nation status. Georgia leaders have suggested they're not going to have two separate primaries to accommodate Joe Biden's wishes. So I think there's still a lot of matters to be settled on the Democratic side. I, for one, think that it's not broke, shouldn't try to fix it. And then Iowa and New Hampshire have done very good jobs being the first in the nation caucus, a first in the nation primary. And I would suspect our party is going to continue with that tradition.
You know, they waited to make that announcement until after the New Hampshire Senate race was decided because they knew they were going to tick off everyone in the Granite State, where I'm heard across the entire state. And I do think the only way you can figure that out is that Joe Biden is afraid of New Hampshire voters and that he's going to run again and he wants a home game. And that's South Carolina. He wants a home game. You know, it's not going to work for Georgia Bulldogs in Atlanta when the Buckeyes take it to him. But Joe Biden wants a home game. So the question becomes, Senator Cotton, when do these Republicans have to figure it out? When do you think they have to get in the game or not get in the game?
Oh, Hugh, everyone is going to make their own decisions on their own timelines. If I recall, in 2016, I guess it was 2015, you had several of my colleagues in the Senate announcing in the spring, back to 1999, George Bush waited until his legislative session was over in the summer. So I would suspect you'd see a lot of different people making decisions between January and then when state legislative season ends and for governors in usually April and May. So I think we still have several more months of kind of the preseason, if you will, before our race is fully engaged.
All right, so we'll come back and talk about that another time. I want to talk about Iran and China. Yesterday, I had Len Khodorkovsky on. I originally scheduled him because Don Lemon at CNN was so rude to him after Donald Trump's infamous dinner that I just thought he needed a chance to say his piece. But then we got to talking about Iran, and Len knows a lot about Iran from his time with Mike Pompeo and Keith Kroc at State Department. Do you think that regime is wobbly? Because it seems that you're too young to remember 1989, I suspect. But all of a sudden, there wasn't an East Germany anymore. All of a sudden, they just threw open the wall and it was over. Could that happen in Iran? Do you think it's happening in Iran?
Well, I actually am old enough to remember that. Not all the ins and outs and the months long lead up to it. But, when something like the Berlin Wall, one of the terrible symbols of the Cold War and the Iron Curtain collapse, even a 12-year-old boy can remember that. I will say that if you look throughout history, to include modern history of the collapse of communist governments in the 1980s throughout the Warsaw Pact, things that seem impossible for the longest time can very quickly turn into inevitable. And the durability of these protests in Iran, I think, has shocked the Ayatollahs. I would call on President Biden to take a more explicit, supportive message for them. You know, I know that all the sophisticates in Washington always say that, oh, well, we don't want to be viewed as instigating the protest or hurting them by saying that, suggesting they're under foreign influence. This is what they always say to justify their inaction. It's what Barack Obama said in 2009 when he refused to support the Green Revolution protesters because he was trying to suck up to the Ayatollahs to get a nuclear deal. It's what Joe Biden and Democrats are saying about protests in China as well, which we know from the history of the Cold War that protesters like the Solidarity Movement in Poland were yearning for words from American presidents in support of their aspirations for freedom. And that's what we should be providing, in addition to walking away from the nuclear negotiations and taking every step we can to hobble Iran's campaign of terror throughout the world.
Now, Senator, I'm holding in my hand this book you might be familiar with, Only the Strong. I want someone from Team Cotton to take your new book, Only the Strong, around to every senator, because I read the hold up on the omnibus, the full year funding of the Department of Defense, as being Democrats wanting more money for non-defense domestic discretionary spending and not enough money for defense. And if they would read Only the Strong, they would know that's not acceptable. Am I right about what's going on?
Yeah, it's actually a major theme of Only the Strong, that the progressive left has not been serious about the defense of America for 100 years. They view the military as just another budgetary account that they can use to fulfill their domestic ambition. And that's exactly what you see this week. We were ready to release the defense bill late last week, and then Democrats began insisting that they add on all kinds of extraneous non-defense measures, whether it's banking for marijuana distributors or a payoff to Joe Manchin to put his permitting reform bill on the defense bill, or to create a journalism cartel paying off the liberal media. These things are all totally irrelevant. And if the Democrats proceed, then I suspect Senate Republicans will filibuster the defense bill until they relent. And for that matter, House Republicans, whose votes are necessary to pass the defense bill, probably won't supply those votes until the Democrats back down. We shouldn't be using the annual defense bill, which supports our troops, as just another domestic plaything to try to fulfill the Democrats' non-defense ambitions.
Senator Cotton, we got 10 seconds. How much up spending over the Biden budget do you think we need and will support in this budget?
Well, the defense bill that's ready to be unveiled shows $45 billion more. I would like more than that. With the House Republican House, I suspect we will get more than that next year, but the need is very urgent given the state of our military and the threats we face.
Senator Tom Cotton, thank you. Always a pleasure to talk to you. Clarity is much appreciated on the Hugh Hewitt Show. Senator Cotton, always clear. Thank you, Senator. Also always clear, I love relieffactor.com. I took it an hour two today, and I'm reminding you in hour three, go out and take it. Use it. Use it every day. You will feel better. You'll get your Christmas tree out of the garage if you've got an artificial tree, or you'll carry it home from the Christmas tree lot without hurting your back. If you're taking Relief Factor, if you hurt your back, the aches and pains will go away much more quickly. But you got to start somewhere. You got to start with Relief Factor today. $19.95 gets you started. The other thing you can start today, the universe. Go subscribe, because beginning today, the 2022 election is over. I begin to look at 2024 with a new feature called GOP News. And it's only available on the universe. And so you got to subscribe, because it's inside the baseball, deep in the weeds stuff. And GOP News will begin today after the regular broadcast show is over. But you got to subscribe to the universe to hear it. All the news from the campaign trail stretching in front of us for 2024. That's on the universe. Stay tuned. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Kristen Waggoner is the president of the Alliance Defending Freedom. Now, often Alliance Defending Freedom is a sponsor of my show. They are not this. They're not paying me for this today. They're not paying the radio station. I'm talking to Kristen Waggoner today because she argued before the Supreme Court yesterday for 2.5 hours on the case of 303 Creative. Kristen, welcome. Congratulations. I listened to a lot of the argument. You were superb.
Well, thank you. I hope you got the rebuttal where I actually got to say what I think. And our plea to the court to provide relief, not just to Lori Smith, but to other artists who are caught in the crosshairs on this issue.
I did, and I want people to understand that when you were standing up there, you were trying to get Colorado to stop interfering with people's speech. It's not a religious liberty case. It's a freedom of speech case. And I thought some of the hypotheticals that came from Justice Brown Jackson just were confusing to me. Did you understand what she was getting at with the Baker?
Not all the time. I think the challenge with the hypotheticals that were being posed is they were extreme situations that would never happen in real life, and the hypotheticals kept changing before the answers could come out. And there was an attempt to try to malign people of faith who believe marriage is between a man and a woman and suggest that this case is about other things, which is just not true.
Now, I did hear Justice Gorsuch rebuke your friendly opposite counsel from Colorado by misstating what had happened to Jack Phillips in the masterpiece. He was forced to go to re-education camp. That's a gloss on what they call it, but what did you make of that exchange? I think he lost Justice Gorsuch at that moment.
I do too. We intentionally reminded the court about the re-education and the reports and the fines in the introduction, and we know that Justice Gorsuch raised concerns about that in Jack's case as well. It's wrong that people are facing fines, re-education, and jail time because they won't speak a message that they believe isn't true.
Now, I believe that you got these weird hypotheticals because they know you're very, very well prepared, that ADF has won 14 cases before the Supreme Court, and you are on very solid ground here. You're going to win at least 6-3, and you might get Justice Kagan in a concurrence. I'm not sure about Sotomayor and Justice Brown Jackson. How do you feel about the breakdown after the argument?
We feel good about it. I mean, it is a pure free speech case. It's about the right of all Americans. No matter what your view is on marriage or any other issue, it's not the government's role to tell you what you can say and can't say. It's a very simple principle. It's one that's worked for throughout our nation's history. We never compelled speech on ideological, political, or religious grounds, and we shouldn't start doing so now. So I think the principle's basic, and it protects every American.
So when the liberal side of the court, the left-wing side of the court, is throwing dust into the air about conduct, I mean, I was baffled by what they were trying to do. I just finally decided they know you've got a slam dunk win, so they're going to try and get people to think this is about racially mixed marriages or something else. I mean, I was truly flabbergasted by the hypotheticals. What, am I just not studious enough?
You should be. It's all they have to throw at it. And frankly, it's illegal to turn people away, to decline to provide service based on a protected class. That's the same today. It will be the same when the court rules. It is illegal to do that. This is about whether you can decide based on the message. As Justice Gorsuch said in the argument, it's about what the message is, not who's requesting it. And that protection extends to all of us. The LGBT website designer who doesn't want to have to create a message that violates her convictions, or the black sculptor who doesn't want to have to design for the Aryan church. We should all have that freedom. Colorado would take that freedom away from America.
Now, is there a real threat to people who are deeply sincere in their religious beliefs? What's the threat to Lori Smith if she's obliged to do websites for same-sex marriages?
Lori is creating custom artwork. These are original websites using her words, her text, her graphics to tell a couple's story, to announce an upcoming wedding, and to celebrate that wedding. The consequences are that if she decides to try to promote her faith view of marriage, she has to promote a different view of marriage. And the court has said time and again that the government can't compel us, intrude on our mind and spirit, to betray our convictions. That's what you see in a totalitarian or authoritarian regime. That's what other countries do that want to repress freedom and move into authoritarianism. And I think the government will respond. I think the court will respond to that. But I would also say, Hugh, that it's important to realize there are cases right now that are at the Court of Appeals where photographers are facing jail time and six-figure penalties for declining to do the same thing that Lori's asking the Freedom to do. And obviously, Colorado's the most aggressive enforcer in the nation.
It's so crucial that you win, that the court is explicit, that they strike down the Colorado statute, and that they begin to enforce religious liberty and First Amendment speech rights in the way that you outlined yesterday. Kristen, congratulations. It was a powerful, masterful performance, and I know you had some hostile justices, but well done, Kristen. And now, please enjoy your holidays, because I know you've been comparing around the clock, right?
Yes, well, I've got MSNBC to do, so just give me some prayer for that one. And then.
Oh, good luck. Who are you going to talk to at MSNBC, Ari or Joy?
I'm not sure who it is, but I'm glad to go on and show up.
Oh, Kristen, that's why ADF gets the support. Go to adflegal.org/you and support them today. adflegal.org/you and support the Alliance Defending Freedom. Hey, Universe members, stick around. Today is the first edition of GOP News, exclusively on the Universe, only for subscribers. The deep weeds of what's going on in the Republican Party, from me, I know it better than anybody else, and I'm about to give it to you over at the Universe. Thanks for listening today. Turn it over to Mike Gallagher on many of these stations. Thank you, Adam. Thank you, Dwayne. Thank you, Jacob. Thank you, America, for listening. Go vote, Georgia. Go vote.